Right, hi. Hello. My name is Stanislas Dabemo, and I'm part of the team at Rescope EU. I won't reintroduce the association. You already saw my colleague, Dan Copeland. And I'm here today to talk about energy efficiency and what kind of value added the cooperatives can get out of energy efficiency. So the base principle for that presentation is that if you want to have an energy transition, you need to go through energy efficiency first. Obviously, not everybody agrees with that statement. That's why, you know what I mean. It happens. But the point is to say that energy efficiency can be used to strengthen business models of cooperatives. So we talked a lot about renewable energy, and that's very important. However, the best kilowatt hour is the kilowatt hour that is not consumed. And that's what I will try to show you today in this presentation, how to encourage members and cooperatives to consume less, to consume better, and therefore to strengthen the business model of your cooperatives. Just to know who's in the room, who of you actually is participating in a cooperative project or has maybe a cooperative project in the future or renewable energy project? Raise your hand. That's not too bad. Yes, thank you. Yeah. All right, that's not too bad. Excellent. So stop me if there's anything that is unclear. The goal is for you to understand what is going on, and you know, if we can help you out to build your project, that's the most important. So the first thing is the Rescope Plus project. So the reason why I'm here today is thanks to that project that is funded by the European Union through the H2020 program. And the idea is to build tools that are encouraging the development of energy efficiency in cooperatives and making business cases for energy efficiency. So as you can see, and that's very important to define what is energy efficiency for us, there's three things. The first one is energy sustainability, which is actually having more efficient installations. So that's, you know, changing the lights, changing the grid, changing your boiler, stuff like that. Energy sobriety, which is changing our habits and behaviors, becoming more sustainable, doing energy savings. And then the third part is energy solidarity, which is to deal as a collective with energy efficiency and therefore support the member of our communities that are more vulnerable than others. Those three parts for us are building energy efficiency, and that's what I will try to talk about today. So never forget those three principles, because that's what we try to achieve here. In order to achieve that, we have six tools that were built by different cooperatives around Europe. Let's see that I forgot some of the percentages, anyways. There are six tools that were built from cooperatives around Europe. The three first ones that you see, so Energy ID, Infoenergia, and Dr. Watt, are around energy savings, so the sobriety part. And then the package approach, technical support, and optimized return flow are more around sustainability, so district heating that we talked about a little bit earlier. As you can see, some of the percentage are missing. It's not that they don't exist, it's just that I forgot to put them on the presentation. So when we made a study around the change of attitude of consumers joining cooperatives, we realized that by joining a cooperative, just simply by becoming a cooperative member, a consumer starts saving energy. We saw their consumption decreasing by 20% in some countries, especially Denmark, when they joined the cooperative. So that already is telling you a lot about the role of the cooperative, the role of community energy in terms of changing the mindset of the consumers and changing the way we see energy. Suddenly we try to build a system that is more efficient altogether, more renewable, and therefore we're also saving money and we're more collective. So on average, more than 50% of the people in the cooperatives that we try to take a look at, try to adopt some of those best practices. And those best practices achieve between 20 and 50% of savings depending on the best practice. So that's because some of them are district heating, so the saving on heating is enormous, and some on energy savings is just behavior change, so that's actually quite low. So let's start. I will go through the six tools, so bear with me, okay? The first one is Energy ID. Energy ID is a platform that was built by EcoPower in Belgium. And Energy ID is looking at basically predictive algorithms that are showing you what would be your consumption if you do not apply the advice of the cooperative. And then you can see how well you're doing compared to your expected consumption. So members are putting in some their consumption figures on the platform, and then the platform is building a profile. Then you can actually take a look at where you are compared to that profile. The interesting part for the cooperative, of course, is that as a cooperative, you have access to the consumption data of your members, and therefore you can also support them by giving them advices and specific advices depending on their consumption. So that is something that can be either sold, that happens in some cooperatives, also it's part of the membership fee for some of the cooperatives, or you can just simply do it because you try to have a more balanced system, so to balance both your consumption and your production. Of course, the goal is to build internal dialogue inside the groups. So to try and get not only members getting information from the cooperative, but also members talking to each other and exchanging, you know, oh, I did that. You know, if I put my washing machine after 10, then I can see that my bill is a lot lower, of course, because you have like night tariffs or stuff like that. So that's really important for them to talk to each other. The results were 28.6% of members engaged with the system, and 10% of the members approximately asked for personal advice from the cooperative. So that was actually quite a successful program, and we're deploying it right now in 3 other countries. So it's deployed in Belgium, we're deploying it in Portugal and Italy as we speak. The second tool is InfoEnergia. InfoEnergia is coming from Spain. It's linked to the SomEnergia cooperative. And the idea here is that in Spain, they deployed smart meters very early, and therefore the goal was to leverage this information from the smart meters and put them on the invoice. So in the invoice, the InfoEnergia service is showing you your consumption compared to other consumers that are exactly like you. So if you're part of a household of 4 people, then we'll show you where you are in terms of energy efficiency compared to other household of 4 people. Are you good? Are you not so good? Are you maybe great, so you're saving a lot of energy, your bill is very low, or your bill is very high? And that helps people, that helps members to figure out, you know, maybe can I do better? What can I do better? And then to go back to the cooperative and ask, what can I do better in the future to maybe save money and save energy? And for that, we saw an about 30% reduction in consumption of each of the members that received that type of service. Dr. Watt. So we saw the predictive algorithm, the invoicing information, and then Dr. Watt is actually going a little bit further. It's coming from a cooperative in France called Enercop, and the idea here is to have a real training program. So it's actually a both online and offline training program. You start with just simply meetings, so that could be also community meetings to start a cooperative, getting together, getting people talking about energy efficiency, what can we do better, should we close the windows when we have, you know, the heating on or the cooling on. And then you go up to actually a 2 weeks training made by the cooperative that is also providing with watt meters, so you can try on and see what is the consumption of each of your appliances. The idea, of course, is to try to get the members to call the cooperative when they're about to make a purchase. So when you're about to change that boiler, when you're about to buy that new fridge, when you're about to buy that new washing machine, what kind of washing machine should I buy? Which one is the right one? Then you call the cooperative, and the cooperative will tell you, well, you know, we actually made a benchmark of those, and you should try, you know, this or that model, or this or that type, depending on the information we have from you. So those 2 weeks of trainings are supported by an online platform where the consumer can also input his information and see the same thing as Energy ID. So, you know, what is my profile? Am I saving? Am I not saving? Am I doing well or not? And that is also supported by the cooperative and by the groups. So what we see also is that people want to have a community around them. So once you've done the training, what we see is that the groups that have done the training together are asking the cooperative to keep them together and organize meeting for them so that they continue meeting each other and continue working together to be more energy efficient. And so that tool allowed 60% of reduction in average monthly consumption. I wouldn't take that figure too seriously. We didn't have a lot of answers on the study, but that's to tell you the people that answered had a huge impact in terms of what they actually achieved. That is, of course, because suddenly you start changing appliances, you start refurbishing your house, you start doing a lot of things in terms of investment, and the cooperative can help you with that. So those were the 3 tools about energy savings. As you can see, it's a lot about changing behaviors, and now we're going to move on to actually changing installations, so being more collective. And I'm going to talk about district heating. A lot of the cooperatives that we work with are from Denmark and Italy, so that's SEV that you heard about before, and EBO from Denmark. And those two basically focused on both implementing district heating, and I know that it's very important in Turkey. I think I saw a study from the MIT that said that Turkey was the 7th country in the world with geothermal capacity. So, I mean, maybe there's something to be done here. And the ideas are both how to implement district heating and how to make it better once you have it. So the first thing is the package deal. So the package deal is very simple. Basically, when you install district heating, the problem is that you need to make sure that a large part of the community is okay with actually implementing that district heating. And so what the cooperative did is to provide a one price for the entire community. The idea is, if we get 30% of you signing up right now, then we install it for everybody at the same price. Which is great for two reasons. Number one, because it encourages people to actually sign up and be willing to implement district heating, but also because some of the most vulnerable customers that maybe wouldn't have the, you know, the money to have it, you know, connected to the district heating, they get also the same price as everybody else, so they can be helped. Of course, that package deal can be also, we have other type of mechanism to support those consumers through, for example, reimbursing those 6,000 euros through your energy bill, stuff like that, to really allow a maximum number of people to actually sign up so we can deploy the largest district heating possible. So that actually allowed for a reduction of 21.42 kilowatt per hour of reduction in consumption. That is on top of what already the district heating is allowing for reduction. So that is not only, you know, we change your oil boiler and therefore you're more efficient, but also on top of that, we see that members try to reduce their consumption simply because they know better, they understand better what is energy consumption. That takes us to the second tool that was put in place, which is the technical support. And technical support is basically the cooperative is providing once a year a checkup to each and every member of the community. So they send an engineer to your house and they're checking your heating system. And the idea here is to say, well, in Denmark there's this very policy that if you are consuming too much, you can get a fine. So the government will fine you because you're consuming too much. Which, I'm French, that's crazy, but, you know, it works, so let's not criticize it. And the idea basically is that the cooperative will pay that fine for you, but then you will have to invest in your own district heating system. So you will have to invest in your heating system itself, so your boiler actually. And the idea here is to say, well, we know that the people that are always paying that fine, always consuming the most, are the people that have the house that are not insulated properly. They are the people that are the most vulnerable, of course. So basically, by putting a fine on them, the only thing we do is to make the situation worse. Or as a collective, we could say, well, it would be a lot more efficient to actually invest in those houses, make them better, and then we actually gain altogether a lot more energy savings. We just go for the low-hanging fruit, simply. So that's basically the core spirit of that technical support. The third tool is return flow optimization, and that is a little bit more technical. The idea is that basically when the flow of water comes back into the TSO level, then the cooperative get penalized or benefits based on the temperature that is coming out. So if your temperature is too low, then you will have to pay a fine to the TSO because they have to reheat that water a lot more. Or if you provide them with a higher temperature of water, then they can use it directly, so they will give you benefit. They will actually give you money for that. So this cooperative in Italy put in place a system that is looking like demand response, where they inform the members about the temperature of the water and encourage them to either lower their heating or increase it based on that temperature in order to have a stable temperature going back to the TSO. And therefore, that brings benefit into the cooperative that is then redistributed to the members. So that's also, you know, financing the next step of the district heating. Is it implementing more smart technologies? Is it going further into the development of the district heating itself? There's a lot of things that can be done. What we see is that the percentage of people signing up for this type of project from this cooperative is gigantic. That's 6.8 of the measures were signed up for by the members. For 9 measures, that's quite big actually. So that's to show you that the level of trust of the members to their cooperative is really big and is really important. And we need to leverage that trust. Because once you have that trust, you can do a lot of different things. You can do, of course, demand response, you can do energy efficiency, but also you can start financing renewable energy. You can start doing bigger projects. You can start doing, you know, different projects as well, going into other sources. So there is a lot of things that can be done. I want to thank you very much for your attention. One last thing, we have a national workshop coming up here in Turkey where I'll bring all the energy experts of the different best practices that you saw today to try to, you know, talk to people, talk to cooperatives. So if you have a project, come in. It's in Izmir with our friends from Troya. And we'll try to, you know, get you as much information as possible, develop your projects, and make sure that this type of best practices get implemented in Turkey. Thank you very much for your attention.